Hold it down.
Hello, it's the beginning of another week. Welcome to Your View. I am Mariah Afolabi, and as always, I have the happy people in the house.
Yes, so.
Yeah,
happy new month, everybody.
Today is actually my stepmother's birthday. I always remember because it's April 1st. And we were just
you can never forget.
I can never forget.
My husband's one is tomorrow.
Happy birthday to Dada, wherever she is. Yeah. Happy birthday to
happy
her.
Happy birthday.
It's a beautiful month. My daughter will be 10 on the 28th of this month.
10.
My first fruit, yes. And I'm so grateful to God. I had a very good time on Saturday. I went for a wedding and I performed my love song, Ife. You know, when they called me to come, they asked me to pray first. Pray for the, you know, you've been in this business for a while now, so give us advice. Mm-hmm. I give them the advice, then I performed. And people were coming to meet me, not because of the performance, but like, I recognize you. Your view, I recognize your view. A particular lady said I should mention her name. Her name is Ada. She says to greet all of you. Greet Mo. She was listing everybody. Greet Mariah, greet Miriam, greet Ada. I've mentioned your name.
All right.
So I had a good time.
How was your weekend?
Oh, yeah, my weekend was good. So I'm getting to this a place in my life that clubbing is no longer interesting.
Oh, and my God.
It has to
call
do
us
with
out.
Phases.
No, yeah.
It's
honestly, I'm someone that really loves dancing, but it's just...
When you go to a club, when everybody on in the club is below 20 or below...
No, it's not that. There's like, okay, people that still do it. I wasn't into those kind of clubbing when I was much younger, and because I like dancing, I went occasionally, but, you know, when you now want to go to church on Sunday, after going to such a place, you'll now be feeling, God, do you understand, you know? But then, I don't think you understand.
That's the phase.
Once you get to a phase, you don't go...
But on Sunday, I had fun. It was
Nina's
mom's hangout. It was so much fun.
I missed it.
They were dancing, there were a lot of competition. The women came to have fun. One lady, she was a performer. She wasn't just, you know, she wasn't just dancing. And I had a great time. I already have like 2 confirmed speaking engagements to churches, and it's going to be evolving around women, because I had a talk on sexual confidence and talking about self-love, accepting yourself and self-awareness. And the lady was saying to me that, we have a church program, it's church, but I think we need this your discussion.
And I think, I always tell people that you started this sexually confident thing, and you need to really sustain it, because
people need to know these things.
A lot of women, I know what the Sexually Confident Conference did to me. It helped me. I mean,
I was there.
It helped me. Oh, really?
I was there.
I didn't remember. Yeah,
you
now I remember
then,
now.
Yeah. I was there.
Yeah, so it helped me. So you should really continue this. It's a major...
But for me, if I want to do a conference, my conference, it's going to be centered around holistic growth. So yeah, growth in sexual confidence, growth in every area. I don't want to do putting multiple events together. I want to do one event that contains holistic growth. But if you invite me to speak on sexual confidence in churches or at events or women in base events, I would come and give it my best. But I didn't want to do a conference.
I'm good.
How was your weekend?
My weekend was
same.
Mommy duty. So that's why I build on you with the club thing. I mean, we started exams this week. So we've been doing our revisions and everything and getting the kids. Now that they're older, it seems it's harder to have them sit down and study. So that's where we are.
Story of my life.
My kids actually studied by themselves now. And even
used
in the
to
car,
be my story.
In the car, this one, they were reminding me of all the things that they learned. That so we're doing. This is different. I was like, okay, you really studied this thing, okay? Thank God, because
that's cool.
At least I'm happy for this place.
I pity myself.
What happened?
I've just been eating. Like, I cannot stop eating.
Mariah, come
literally.
On. Breastfeeding.
I mean, I had pounded yam 10 p.m. last night.
No excusing.
That's something I never eat at night. I never eat past 7 p.m. last night. I'd eaten at 5 o'clock. That's a mignon.
Okay.
Mama Brown made mignon for the whole house. Because we have guests now. So that another Anikiti woman, that's the best meal you can offer your guests.
Mariah, so she take made it one day at a time. When you're done with breastfeeding, then you take care of yourself.
I'm just saying that I'm just amazed that I can finish pounded yam at 10 p.m.
I was shocked. Surprised.
That I actually went to the pot at 10 p.m.
Oh God,
and I was eating pounded yam. And I was relishing.
You're losing nutrients.
There's something called efogbagba. Do you know efogbagba?
No.
Oh, what's man, that? You got to try that stuff, man.
Are you kidding? That's the deal.
Efogbagba is unbelievable. She made it with egusi.
Did she bring it from...
She brought it, you know, and with egusi and...
Are there more raw efo remaining?
I don't
Can
think
we come
so.
And
she
eat
made,
after...
She made
show?
Everything. Man, that... And she was telling me, you go to the toilet, I'm like, toilet, okay? It's pounded yam. What? I visited number two, man. I was like, what's good?
If you're eating proper food, that's fine.
That's fine.
It is when you're eating when you're chocolate, done, you can't just take it.
Oh, trust me, I'm eating chocolate.
As well.
The chocolate in the
pizza. Enjoy your breastfeeding.
Man, I just can't stop eating, man.
Enjoy
it. I'll enjoy it, though. 6 months, I'll start my diet.
Ah.
I'm telling you, it's not easy. But let's go on a break. It's Monday. Let's find out what the papers are saying. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Right, let's start with The Nation today. Governors push for Lawan in race for Senate President. By Dabia Mila, why I want to be Speaker. House leader gets support. Former Lagos City Council clerk Fashinro dies at 99. Lagos retains Fitch B+ rating despite Vision Skip's payments default. Southwest won't play second fiddle, says Oni. Rivers APC-PDP quarrel as coalition resumes. And farmer kills two villagers in Ogun. Okay.
So, coalition resumes finally, the Rivers elections. And the APC party in Rivers State, the chapter are alleging that the coalition officer is going to try to manipulate the election results to favor PDP. And we must remember that the APC did not contest in the March 9th election because they were disqualified by INEC. However, they decided to support the AAC candidates. And so they're expecting that the vote should go to AAC. I just want there to be free. It should be seen to be free and fair.
Right.
And they should do the right thing.
The farmer who shot two people, this happened in Ogun State, so the villagers are worried about the farmer because he shot one at a close range just as he was going to the farm. The second one he shot when they organized a manhunt to get him, and then he shot somebody and he was telling them that if they come after him, he's going to kill about 8 more people.
Is this saying?
The police is saying that they have not gotten a report on the incident. So I just pray, I think it's a case of mental illness, and I pray that he should be arrested so that he can stop that.
There's another story that caught my attention in The Nation. We're excited about, Lagos State is excited that the fact that the contract with Visionscape went, their ratings with Fitch still maintain the B+, which is great for them. It's a global rating that helps them
get investors
to come to the country. Let's move on to the New Telegraph. Goje Adamu back out of Senate presidency race. El-Rufai takes former Gombe governor to Buhari. Picture here, customs seizes 275 million naira worth Rolls Royce, G-Wagon, Brabus, Bugatti, Blend. Which one of this one is Bugatti? I don't know which.
I don't know Bugatti.
I know Rolls Royce. I know Mercedes. I know, but that Bugatti. I always hear Bugatti in music.
In video. Music video.
We'll Google seen it. Look, I'll Google it. Yeah, thank you. NCAA wants pilots airlines over hazardous weather. Reused cooking oil may trigger breast cancer spread. Senior school prefect falls off a mango tree and dies. Stock markets post 48 billion naira loss in Q1 2019. And 8 banks garnered 15.4 trillion deposits in 2018. So let's talk about the Bugatti first.
The
senior prefect, he was told by his teacher, and he had organized the private lesson, you know, and he was
Saturday.
Told by his, on, for Saturday, and he was told by his teacher to go and pick up mangoes from a tree, and he climbed the pluck mangoes from a tree, and then he fell off and died. And they were, reports also said that some other people, two other kids had died from picking up, plucking.
Four kids, yeah.
Have died from plucking mango from that tree.
But I think that the school sending them to go and pluck mangoes for them.
Okay, so I think that one they should uproot that mango tree. Because if four people have died, we already have 5 people dead from that mango tree.
Yeah. It means that evil tree.
They should just uproot it.
Nutritionists are discouraging the reuse of cooking oil. You know, like when you fry and then you use it to fry again and fry again and fry again. So they conducted a research, cancer prevention research, and they found out that in the long run, it will lead to stage 4 cancer for women. And they use the lab rats to do that.
Can they tell us how long we can use the oil for cooking?
Just use your oil once. You don't need to reuse.
Vegetable oils,
soybean oil, coconut, whatever oil you use, don't reuse.
I've read that long ago. I thought everybody knew about it. That
please, and we are all guilty. Me, I can fry fish with one oil for a long time. Just keep
it. So the officials of customs.
Yeah,
the Nigerian customs.
What happened?
So
all the cars, as she named them, Bugatti and everything, they've been seized.
Okay.
That's one. Then we have rice, bags of rice.
Over 2,900.
Yeah, tons of rice.
Another person.
Imported rice.
Same
furniture.
Container.
No, same container. Furniture as well. So the thing is, some of these things are contraband. Some of them are not contraband, but people are not, you know, they would lie about what they are bringing it. They would declare the exact thing so that they do not pay the exact duty on them. Mm. And then they impounded them.
Let's move on to the punch. Speakership race. APC reps others backed by Jabir Mila. PDP to meet lawmakers elect. Man watching football shot dead by SARS. I thought SARS were already suspended. I can cause trouble for Nigeria if provoked, says Nnamdi Kanu. Delayed appeal court's decision worry on Onega's lawyers. Husband, wife, two children. Nine others die in Bauchi crash. Federal government revert to January December budget cycle in 2020. Okay, so let's start with the man who got shot by SARS.
Yes, so SARS operatives launched a raid in an eatery where they were watching the Premiership football, and then they were about to arrest the man, but then his friend started challenging them, and they shot one of the operatives. The man, point blank, he died. So youths in the area decided to set up a bonfire protesting the death of the man. I think the man should, the SARS operative should be arrested and prosecuted. Really? And I also think that all these happy, trigger-happy police officials should be, somebody should set an example so that other people will be deterred from just shooting people.
To continue, please, our budget cycle from next year, that's 2020, they are promising us, the Minister for Budget and Strategy Planning, has said that we will start having our budgets from January to December. We still haven't passed the budget for this year yet, and we're already in April. So now they've promised us that by next year, we would have the budget properly planned to start from January to December. Okay. We are going to hold them accountable because we hear these things many times and then we forget.
Well, leave that matter. How many things have we held them accountable? Let us move on to the next paper, please. We'll hold them accountable on this table. No problem. Moving on to Vanguard. Rep speakership. Intrigues, tension at 17. Jostle. That's Jabir Mila joins the race. Rallies PDP, APGA, EA, others. Let's see. Which story? Local Lagos State government condemns prison sentence for children, seeks correctional homes. Courts grant Serap nod to compel Fashola to name corrupt contractors. Afenifere tackles Fayemi on restructuring. Nigeria's now sixth most miserable people globally. Me, I'm not miserable, is she? Plane crash. My death would have put many in trouble, says Oshimbajo. And others are just bank issues. Yes.
So Lagos State government is condemning putting children who have committed crimes and putting them in prison as a way of rehabilitating them. It says it causes, you know, it affects their mental health because a lot of things in the prisons would affect them. It's a whole different, almost hostile environment. So they're advocating for rehabilitation homes for children that have committed crimes.
Great. So and, the SERAP, the socio-economic reforms projects, I've taken the case of information, Freedom of Information Bill to court, and they've been given the nod to request that the Minister for Power, Housing and should submit the list of everyone who, in the democratic dispensation since 1999, was paid fully for a contract and hasn't executed it. The idea was Atiku during his campaign mentioned over and over again that some people have been paid full for some contracts and they didn't carry out power projects. And so now we're expecting that SERAP will follow up with the Minister Fashola, and we know that Mr. Fashola, you are very responsive. You would give us this list because we need to start naming and shaming these people. Beyond that, we should prosecute them because if they've been paid and they didn't carry out the project, they should refund us.
They need to answer to us.
Our vice president was saying that a lot of people would have been put in trouble if he had died because it was from Kwara, I think. It was flying in from Kwara. Was it Kwara or Kogi?
Kogi. I know he went to Kogi.
So it was just that people would be in trouble. I mean, I questioned what happened, what caused his death, if that had happened. So it was given that the Thanksgiving service,
the people.
Their winning Thanksgiving service they had in Aso Rock. Yeah. Were the six most miserable? Who read that story?
Yeah, so data has been compiled at the...
Who compiled this data?
Steve Hanke, I think is his name.
An economist
at the Johns Hopkins. So based on, they said Nigeria is the sixth most miserable country.
Where did they get this miserable index from?
The miserable index is based on They use economic indices like unemployment, inflation, and bank lending rates.
We're happy
so
people here.
So based on that, we're the sixth most miserable country. Okay. But I said that they forgot to add our religiosity, that's the churches. It gives us one sort of extra hope in Nigeria. So all these things, we may look like we're miserable, but once you just put church,
Miriam,
everything
we
just
reject
disappears.
That. We reject that.
Okay, good.
Badabi Amila addressed a conference, you know, he was telling people why he is the perfect person to be the speaker. In there, he mentioned how, being that he was a minority leader before, he has tasted both being a minority and being in the majority. Mm-hmm. He can best handle how to deal with both sides of the party, the system within the House of Representatives.
This story, we forgot, we didn't mention it. The couple, two children die in Bauchi auto crash. Very sad story.
Oh, yeah.
There were about 18, or there was an 18-seater bus, or 13 of them died. Really, really, it was like a head-on collision.
Oh,
I mean, we say these are the same stories we say
every single
time.
Yes, the numbers change, the location change, but
speeding out.
So. Unfortunately, that's all we can take on all the papers. When we come back, we'll discuss trending topics. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So we observe lots and lots of hot trending news on social media. Recently, the Minister of Agriculture, Aldo Ogbe, made a startling revelation when he appeared before the Senate Committee on Agriculture, stating that some Nigerians actually import everything, including, wait for it, pizza from the UK. According to him, these orders are made in the morning through British Airlines. He further stated that this is very annoying. What are your thoughts on this? Some people say it's not annoying. What's your business? Is it your money? You can call us on 070-806-6804. You can also tweet to us at TVC. You can increase hashtag YourViewTVC so we can read your tweets. So people went for him on Twitter saying that, oh, God, mind your business.
It's not your money.
But the truth is, does that make sense for people to be actually ordering pizza? Because you have the money, you have the means.
Is that story true?
It's no. We've had stories of Mariam's siblings, northerners, all of you are in the same family, that they would be watching game in the UK and they would fly a private jet to the north to pick up suya and pick up, you know, that they are going to eat over there. Do you understand? So people have been doing this thing.
Are you for real?
Yes, they order suya. The private jet will come here, pick up. It's 6 hours now, so they know that they want to watch the games with fresh suya. So they come here, pick up suya.
Or they had sausages. Particular kind of sausage that you like, ham that you
people,
like.
People do this thing. From the minister, a lot of people were saying that, oh, this man was very informed. Let's watch the video. When I finish watching the video, I'm like, why are you telling me what I already know?
It's obvious.
What I want you to tell me is the solution. What exactly are you doing to prevent this
he
thing?
Can't do anything
what are you
to prevent
doing?
It. That, that, he can't.
His lamentation was plenty. Oh, how there is a. it was, for me, it sounded like
talk
a lamentation. How we were importing toothpicks. How have you funded toothpicks company in production companies in Nigeria? Had Ericsson that was doing tomatoes shut down. Mm-hmm. We were celebrating here on the show when they opened up that we have tomato paste now.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying that there's a cabal, that there are people that are benefiting from importation. So what are you doing to deal with this cabal?
Why is it a big deal for people to import
here
or consume international products?
We are a consumer nation, and for whatever reason, Nigerians do not believe in what they produce. That I know. I was in the fashion industry and I knew that it's easy for them to just, you know, order those clothes. Because the truth is, because of the importation, sometimes it's cheaper to buy the foreign clothes than the homemade clothes, which we know. So same with food as well. So if you compare the amount you pay for the local rice, the amount you have, you pay for the local rice here, it's more expensive than when you buy the foreign
bread
rice. So the common man in Nigeria is trying to make ends meet. They are trying to save cost and buy what they can afford.
Mm-hmm.
So what I expect him to do and what I expect the government to do is put measures in place that will encourage these farmers, encourage the people in the production industry so that they can make things more affordable for us.
I doubt we are the ones going to be giving him this kind of information. I doubt the minister doesn't know what to do concerning the Ministry of Agriculture.
Concerning these little 0.00000% of Nigerians that order pizza or ham or so. I mean, this is something that the rich do. So, you know, recently it was in the papers that there was over 300 million worth cashew nuts that was supposed to have been sent, that was supposed to have been exported.
Mm. I think it's 500 million.
Yeah, tons. 300 million. Okay. Dollars.
Worth,
that, yes.
Worth, yes.
So it's been in the at the port since January.
Imagine. Mm.
And the foreign buyers are tired, you know, right. They're tired of waiting and everything. And people who are doing this business have been giving money.
Yeah,
they've
lost money.
They've lost money.
Really sad.
And
really sad,
this is sad. So this is what
I think it's about 50,000 tons.
Yeah. 50,000 tons.
What's 300 million?
Let me take this call from, I can't remember. Hello. Abdul, thanks for calling. Are you there?
Yeah, good morning.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Yes. I'm sorry, I have to deviate from what your current topic. So
go
the
ahead.
Newspaper review.
Yes.
Where the sad person shot and killed an unharmed citizen.
Right.
Yes.
Yes. As much as I condemn that act, we should be asking ourselves, why will an unarmed citizen want to stop a police officer on his official duty from performing his duty?
Okay.
And secondly, what kind of weapons do you expect, secondly, if you remember the video of the DCA star in Bielsa, the people that molested that man were unarmed.
Right.
If his boys are shot, we'll be talking about shooting them, the unarmed citizen, instead of talking of the people disobeying the law of the land.
Hmm. Okay.
Those people that molested a deputy commissioner of police, who federal government has spent over $1 billion to train to that rank, unharmed.
Right.
So if those men are didn't protect their life now, maybe they must kill.
Thank you very much, Abdul, for your views. Yeah. I appreciate it.
Just quickly to Abdul, you know that there's been the story of how SARS sort of, you know, the story has been there, consistently abuse Nigerian citizens. So I think you can understand why people would think they need to stand up to them, you know, when they come on.
But I think what I'm hearing Abdul say that, listen, don't stand up to an official with a gun.
She obeyed the law. Yes,
just
we have had,
hands off.
But we've had them victimize people unlawfully
right.
and
so
then take them and go
there are arguments both ways.
That's our topic, though.
We have to run. But yeah, let me let you drop.
But I feel that the government doesn't have business in doing business. Their job is to provide enabling environment for every Nigerian to put money in and succeed. But when the environment is not there, they must step in. The cashew business people have lost money.
Mm.
And they will not be encouraged to go back and do that business. They will just sit down and probably import something else that would make them make it profitable. So the environment needs to be more conducive. Don't complain about the rich. And encourage those that are doing businesses to do well.
Okay, that's what we can take on that hot topic. When we come back, this issue of building collapse hasn't left the scene. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So we have had back-to-back incidences of building collapsing here in Lagos have claimed so many lives, lives that could have been avoided. On the show this morning, we have with us the Acting General Manager, Lagos State Building Control Agency, Engineer Lekan Shodendi. Welcome to the show, sir.
Good morning. Thank you.
You can call us on 070-8066-8014. You can also tweet to us at TVC Connect. Please hashtag your view TVC so we can read your tweet. Okay, so the last few weeks, we're talking about building collapse, and it's important that we don't just review what happened, we also need to plan ahead going forward so it doesn't happen again.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, most of the collapsed buildings we're seeing have been on the Lagos Island. Is there any reason for this?
Thank you very much. Well, it can be, overtly specific.
Right.
But you know, if you look at the historical trajectory of how Lagos Island has evolved,
right,
it could be adduced to the mode of development. I mean, the informal concept,
right,
association, that has, you know, encouraged
right
the development. I mean, Island used to be more of a family setting, compound with
right
zinc structures, small housing, you know, home settlements. But with time and the demise of the real landowners and families taking over and the need to improve, you know, people have not, you know, overtly planned development. And you are having clusters
mm
of not to habitable structures on the island. Mm. So it's that historical over the last 25, 30 years. And as at then, most of these houses that are collapsed are those houses that were built by these informal sector developers then that are now, you know.
It's difficult to, people are asking why. Why the collapse? What happened? What processes were put in place? What processes were not put in place actually at the time when these buildings were put together? Were you able to tell us what happened? What went wrong exactly?
Now, the total problem in this in the built sector in Lagos, in Nigeria as a whole, or well, I'll be specific in Lagos State, is a people problem. The laws have been, has always been there from time immemorial since I've historically. We all know about Macaulay, right?
Yeah.
He's one of the foremost planners around. So since this time, there has always been one form of law or regulation that guides development. So the challenge we have is people not playing their part, expecting government to be the one to now forcefully make you comply. If you have to police everybody from being an armed robber, I don't think we're going to be successful.
Right.
But because a lot of us decide to be legal citizens, only few people are criminals, so it's easy to police that act.
Right.
But conversely, in this sector, almost everybody has a negative mindset. And we all expect government to now police everybody to comply.
When you say everybody.
Okay, so what I'm hearing you say now is that the government that is supposed to enforce this law is unable to do it. It's incapacitated or you're not strong enough to do it because that is your job to enforce the law. There will be people that will break it. There will be people that will consciously break it. Some people may not consciously know that they are breaking the law. So the government is supposed to enforce it. Are you saying you're unable to do that?
We are enforcing. But when you look at the enormity of enforcement required, enormity.
You're incapacitated then.
Yeah, because the volume is huge.
The ones that you've marked for demolition, how do you come about saying that they must be demolished? What are the criteria you put in place to say that they have to be demolished?
I've listened to several TV programs and radio programs where they say once a building has been marked, why didn't we demolish? Mm-hmm. Let me clear that. Not every marked building must be demolished.
Okay.
Not every.
Oh, I thought when it's marked for demolition.
That is the error. That's an erroneous impression.
Okay.
Quite erroneous. What the X mark means is that this building is under investigation. Stay off.
So
it's a danger zone. Stay off. It's a criminal site. Stay off.
Right.
Because we believe we use the word distressed building loosely. But what that means is that this building has a form of structural failure.
Right.
To what degree, we don't know.
Okay, till it's
but
being tested.
The owner has to do some scientific tests to convince government that, okay, this building is good. I mean, you can still fix it. I said it on the phone the other day that Lagos State hasn't got enough housing stock. We're not in a hurry to reduce what we have.
Right. Mm.
If we can still salvage some, we want to spend good time to salvage it rather than throwing people on the street. So you see, defect doesn't mean pull it down.
Right.
Okay. You can still re-engineer it and make it safe for habitation.
Okay. All right. Are you saying now, sir, that buildings have expiry dates? Because sometimes a friend of mine was telling me that before a building gets to that collapse stage, it begins to throw stones. And then people who are inside see those stones, but then they want to pray it away. Are we saying that we should, when you're getting into a house or you're buying a house or you're renting, you should ask for the expiry date of that building? Is there anything like an expiry date?
Let me do a little bit of engineering here.
Okay.
In engineering, where you're doing the design for the structural stability of the house, the minimum lifespan of a building is 50 years.
50 years.
Minimum.
Minimum.
But if you give the house or the structure the required nourishment, it can
last
last centuries.
Oh.
Because you're not, it's as if it's going to deteriorate. Deterioration sets into a building when left unattended to.
Okay.
If you allow water to leak into your structural elements over time, it will destroy everything.
Right.
But once you give the building the right nourishment, you attend to it as you ought to. We've seen buildings, you guys are well traveled.
Okay.
That will last centuries.
Now let's go to those who have been evacuated or that for whatever reason their houses have been demolished.
We're doing some exercises now.
You started demolishing quite a number of buildings. The people that are residing in those buildings, what's going to happen to them?
Oh, well, the government made a robust arrangement for that. Okay. We have these two resettlement locations, at one at Igondo and the other at Agbowa in Ikorodu.
Igondo,
okay. Like Igondo, from Lagos Island, they go to Igondo and
well,
they go
to Igondo. I beg, please, if they don't give you, say they didn't give you.
I'm just asking, I was just...
Go ahead, please. Igondo
so,
and where?
The state government had made that provision available, okay. So when we, you know, are doing the removal, okay. We Enumerate and LASEMA and our agency cooperate to... Okay. But if you, so I mean, it's a voluntary thing.
A house?
Yeah, it's a house.
Okay.
It's a house.
It's temporary. How long is this going to be for?
For the first 3 months now. Three months in the first instance.
Okay. 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 So the
question, BCBG, okay. The Building Collapse Prevention Guild. Yes, since you're familiar with them, said that 36,000 houses in Lagos.
6,000, you are saying.
36. They said 30,000. Yes, houses are in Lagos are in danger of collapse. You know, and that I know that you already said we don't even have enough houses. So if you say 36,000 houses are in danger of collapse, what are we going to do? Now, in order to prevent it, you already said some houses can actually be structurally, and I know someone whose house was having a crack because of they removed a pillar in trying to do aesthetics in the building. Yes, and they had to re-put the pillar and redo a lot of work. And the house is structurally fit now. So I know that some houses can be salvaged, but what is your agency doing so that these 36,000 houses that have been said that are endangered, what are you doing to prevent them from costing us lives?
Please, I want to first clear that. Please don't let's scare allegations. Where BCPG got that data, I don't know. I think on Saturday I was on this radio station, somebody said 1,000 on Lagos Island, and I'm scared that 36,000, well, it's a, but anyway, what we're being proactive, you know, government is guided by the law. Mm. We can't just do anything. Mm. So a lot of our activities and actions are actually guided by the law. If you take government to court, I can't do this, hey, you have to stop and wait for the law.
Okay, let's go on a quick break. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation with our guests. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. Mariam was waiting for a question.
Yes, I was going to ask. I just need to understand, because I asked this question over and over again after the collapse, which is who dropped the ball? When you have, we know people build structurally deficient homes, but then people that come into the place to rent it may not know of all the issues. So who is it your agency that is in charge of maybe going around these buildings and making people aware that this may have a problem, apart from the X, because some buildings, I have been to that Lagos Island, and I have seen buildings, just with my own layman's idea, it looks like it's about to collapse, and there is no X on it. So I'm saying, is there anybody that goes to tell people when they go to rent? Yeah. Is it your agency that's in charge of making sure people don't endanger their lives?
No. I was saying earlier that the law guides government. Mm-hmm. We don't just put an X on every building on day one. Because, I mean, no magician can see this house is distressed. But when you see the sign of distress, we have officers daily on the streets monitoring the entire Lagos. Mm-hmm. When you see a building, there are notices, alerts, that are given to the owners and the occupiers. The landlord might not live there, but people are living there. Mm-hmm. We'll serve what we call a contravention notice.
Okay.
That will tell you these houses are assumed or suspect to be distressed, to be in distress.
And what's the normal response you get from Nigerians when you do that?
You know what it is.
No, just tell us.
It's not really, you know, forthcoming. Because when you serve the notice, you say maybe wait for like a week or two. Mm. But if it is occupied, we definitely now go back to serve another notice called quit notice.
Okay.
We advise them to quit, to leave the building. Because in as much as this building is still this distress, and if not properly attended to, it will further deteriorate. So get out. If they don't get out, we go back again to have another notice called seal up notice that we're coming to seal up.
Okay.
Eventually, we will seal and evacuate everybody.
So when a collapse happens, then it becomes whose fault in that case?
When a collapse happens, on our records, we have sealed the building. Okay. We have allowed to put, we don't go, because the question was, how did they know that this building is risky? Because we have done that. We have alerted, given enough alert to
people. So they should have evacuated the house.
Well, don't ask me out of my own bit, but I can tell you the Lagos State government is doing all it can to make sure housing stock is available. We have the rent-to-own option. You don't have to look for the 10, 20, whatever million to buy. You can rent with an option to own eventually. So I think government, I mean, I know there's a program on right now that for about, the government supported like 100,000 housing units all over the state. So it's a daily thing. The demand is there, and we're trying to meet up with the demand.
So what happens when your house as a landlord is marked for X? What's the step you're supposed to take? Because we hear a lot of people get their houses marked and then they don't do anything about it.
Unfortunately,
as a landlord, when you get that, what do you do?
Before you get the X, the moment you get the contravention, the first notice, approach a registered laboratory to come and do an integrity test on the building.
Where do you get that?
Look, there's the Lagos Material Testing Laboratory at Ojudu Bega, and they have registered affiliates that work with them that can do the report for you.
Okay.
Once you do the report, just get structural engineer to do the appraisal, analyze everything. Approach LAPCA with the SOVD, you're finding, okay, this building has this defect, these are the members that are bad, we want to fix
that's
it.
That's supposed to be your job as the landlord.
How
expensive it is. Is it?
I mean the report, the test.
Yeah, you know, you're going to
depending
get
on the
test.
Complexity, how big your house is.
Right.
But for a normal residential size, one plot house, I think per floor is about 50,000 naira for residential.
Per floor.
Please, yeah. I have a question.
I'll come to you. Let me take this call from Jack. Jack, are you there? Thanks for calling.
Hello, good morning.
Morning, go ahead, please.
I want to start by reiterating some of the conversations you guys have had prior to this particular one. First, about the agricultural thing and all of that stuff. I think our major problem, it's not about trying to, you can't stop people from importing stuff you don't provide.
You get what I'm saying?
Right. So plus, if you're going to go about saying, oh, stop importing this stuff, then you have to provide it. So one thing I think, what I think we should come about doing is creating platforms to actually create and make those stuff. Take, for example, the beautiful clothes you all are putting on. I mean, the materials you get we don't make those materials.
Oh, we do, Abba, trust me.
Made in Nigeria.
The materials, we don't make
them. Materials.
Okay, so, I mean, so we get to that part.
Right.
Where we have deficiency in performing.
When a building doesn't get proper approval and it gets and is collapsed, whose job on your own end was it to ensure that before this building goes up to that extent, it should have been approved? What punishment does
it
that person get? Yes. It wasn't
rather,
approved.
The owners of approval is on the owner, not on government.
So
the owner ought to have obtained approval before progressing.
So when a building goes up, shouldn't your agency check that this building, was it approved? Their building, it's not an unknown building.
From the records I got, before the project got to that level of collapse, several enforcement had been done on that site.
Okay.
You know, like I said, we are guided by the law. You go to a site, you seal it up. And once you see a red and white tape on the site, it becomes a criminal site, don't go there. Don't dare. But our people have, over time, ignored government, and they've gone ahead to continue. You understand? So it's touching the entire state. If I have to cover the entire 57 L's and LCDAs and have limited enforcement capacity, so I leave it to
you. Give
today.
Us a number we can call.
We have toll free lines.
Give us that number that people can call now if they see a building that they feel isn't approved or something.
We like the
website.
We have a toll free line. Okay. Website is Lagos City. We are on the Lagos City government website. Well, we have two toll free lines. Those cost you a dime. A cobble, 07-00-527-222. I'll take it again. 07-00-527-222. The other one is 07-00-50-50-40-40. 07-00-50-50-40-40. We want people to work with us, to give us information. That's what we eat and we live every day.
We have to round up, and I want to end with this question. So, people have died. And you're working tirelessly to ensure it doesn't happen again.
It doesn't happen again.
Now, going with the mega city plan you have, how many more buildings should we expect to be destroyed in the next?
Wow, that's a serious word, destroyed.
Taken down.
Demolished.
Removed.
Removed.
That's better. Okay. Removed. Well, we did some about 40 in 2017. We're doing about 51 now.
Okay.
All over the state, not just Lagos Island, all over the state. But on our records, suspected distressed buildings over 300.
Okay.
382, precisely.
Okay.
But not all will be demolished. But like I told you, the model we are doing now will kick into this one. That rather than forfeiting you know, on collapse or demolition. We're going to ensure
that
these
buildings... Can you provide this information on your website where we know the houses the that have been destroyed? Oh, sure. So people need to...
Don't go and rent.
You don't go and rent them. And people now are warned because we don't want that to happen again.
We will.
It's important.
Because we don't want government... government needs to be careful. If you put on the website, this building is distressed... Somebody can take a score like, why are you embarrassing me and say my building is distressed when you have not really confirmed?
As long as it's going to save lives.
Once you have not confirmed. So we need to do a test to confirm the distress.
Yes.
I mean, we're guided by the law too, so we need to be careful.
Very careful. Well, thank you so much. We just hope that we really don't want to call you back here for another building collapse.
Come and collapse.
Yeah. That's all we can take. When we come back, we'll discuss this issue of minimum wage versus the VAT. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Stay tuned. Your View will be right back. Welcome back to Your View.
Thanks for staying with us. So recently, the new minimum wage the Nigerians have been clamoring for was approved by the federal government. Today, we will be looking at the imminent effect it has on Nigerian workers, the economy, and regards to standard of living and quality of life, purchasing power, and several other issues. Join us on the show is a social commentator, a seasoned diplomat. He is the former Deputy High Commissioner of Nigeria to United Kingdom, Ambassador Oluwatoyin Lawal. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you so very much.
You can call us on 070-806-68014. You can also tweet to us at TVConnect. Please hashtag YourViewTVC so we can read your tweets. All right, so we've been discussing minimum wage for a while, and finally the federal government has approved it. Although some governors have talked about the revenue sharing formula for... From the money allocated to them from the federal government. In your view, do you think that this minimum wage would work for everybody across board, or what do you think would be the best approach for other states who can't afford to pay this amount of money?
Thank you very much once again. Good morning to everybody. You ladies, I'll be remiss in my responsibility if I do not, commend you on what you've been doing,
yes, sir.
Because you apparently remind me of Barbara Walters and the Gopi Wilberg, Joy Behar, and all the rest of them.
Thank
you so you're doing very, very, very well.
Thank you very much.
You have succeeded in raising the level of social, political, economic discourse.
Thank you, sir.
You know, please continue on that track. We appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you.
Yeah. To the question you ask, the minimum wage is a child of necessity because our country, for example, since the journey as per the minimum wage started in 1981-82 during the Shagari era. Then after that, I think there was one or two review, but the last one that I can capture vividly is the bill presented by the Justice Alpha Belgore committee, when he presented a bill with respect to the minimum wage to the National Assembly then after that, we have not been able to do a review, of this. But we do know that in a country as vast as this, as blessed as we are, it is a shame for the minimum wage to be as low as 18,000 Naira. So there have been a lot of clamoring for a review. So thank God the APC government has finally, birthed a new minimum wage. This minimum wage, there are a lot of issues surrounding it. Opinions vary, as it does with, all other issues. For example, people will be very happy that here we have the minimum wage, but there are other...
States are saying that they can't afford it. I mean, some states are saying, listen, I can't afford it. Although there was, I think it was 22,500 that was initially proposed.
Yeah.
Now, we're hearing that there might be some kind of formula to change the revenue, what is allocated to each state. Do you think that would make a lot of sense, or do you think states should try to generate this amount?
For me, my opinion is that states that are saying that they cannot afford it should actually put their thinking caps on. There is no state in the Federation of Nigeria as it stands today that is barren of natural resources. Hmm. We have enough resources. God gave Nigeria all he can give.
And I just feel that we've had speculations that the VAT would be increased likely in order to fund the minimum wage. Shouldn't we be looking at other options aside the VAT?
Absolutely. I agree with you. The idea of increasing the VAT is a no-no, as far as I'm concerned.
Okay.
To the extent that I've just said that there are other measures that can be put in place, because we are not looking at Lagos only. We have Rivers State, we have some other, you know, states in the Federation who, you know, which can actually, you know, pay the minimum wage without any doubt, without any problem. Of course, there are states that are complaining, but I'm telling you, with all sense of responsibility, that these states can actually do a lot of introspection, you know, and when they do that, they can come up with avenues, you know, to raise money. Because when you look at it from the perspective of the primary purpose of government, after all, to ensure the welfare of the people.
Yeah.
You know? So let me I'll come to you, Marianne. I think a couple of days ago was Ashwa Jubala met Tinubu's colloquium.
Yeah.
And he said something about widening the tax bracket, that even him should be taxed, that if he includes him tax, they're paying taxes, ensure that they pay taxes, to ensure more people are paying money to the government's coffers. Now, you've worked as a diplomat, and you see how the rich are taxed, and how every citizen abroad at least is paying almost through their nose, or every item is taxed. In your view, what can the government do better to increase that tax bracket within this country?
If, for example, what are we talking about, the IGR in Lagos State? Lagos State is making a lot of progress because of the creativity that Ashiwaju and the rest of them have brought into governance.
But can you compare Lagos State to somewhere like Zamfara? It's not a fair comparison, because Lagos State obviously has so many.
At the same time, you find out that many of the problems we have, you know, you have to trace them to a network, you know, this patronage system. You know, when a government comes in at the state level, even such states that you're talking about, they bring in a retinue of aides that by the time you...
But Shola didn't do that. People were against it and for it, but he didn't, in a way to curb, to reduce expenses. And he still had major issues. So, and I do not, he's someone I respect, his political acumen, and he's also a very brilliant man, did well while he was a commissioner in Lagos. Yeah. But when he had to serve as a governor in Osun
State,
he had a major struggle. Yeah. He had major struggles. So it's beyond just saying, oh, put your thinking caps on. There must be policies that will make it conducive and make the governor able to work.
Okay, let me take this call. Thanks for calling. Are you there? Hello, Ibrahim. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead. You're live. Go ahead, Ibrahim.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, talking about the issue on ground, I think what the federal government is trying to do is like giving someone a bit with your right hand and taking it back with your left hand. If you want to look at it from the administrative point of view, we expect the federal government of Nigeria, if they want to then implement the new minimum wage, they should look at other areas in which they can source for funds to implement this peacefully. By increasing the VAT, it means people will still be suffering and living within the same circle. So they should look at other areas, like cutting of salaries and allowances of government officials. Looking at salaries...
We have gotten tired of saying it, Ibrahim. We have said it over and over here.
It's a good idea. It's a good policy, the increase in the minimum wage. But are we ready to do it right now?
You see, in our economy today, I can comfortably tell you that part of the reason a lot of these states are complaining, you know, one...
They are lazy.
No, you know, fact is fact. They are lazy and they are not doing what they are supposed to do. For example, if you look at, I've mentioned the number of aides. What do you need
Thank you,
so many aides for? You know, Why can't we just, you know, be good enough to know that people...
The aids can be useful. But they should be useful.
Not so many.
But they should be useful. They can be useful, but they should be useful.
For example, in the past, I was told that there was a governor in the northern part of the country that had over 5,000 aids.
For what?
I mean, you begin to question, you know, when...
But let me take this call. Abbas from Yobi, are you there? Thanks for calling.
Yeah, good morning.
Akpan, go ahead, please.
My own contribution, I'm a first-time caller as well.
Oh, you're welcome.
My own contribution is, looking at this minimum wage, I'm suggesting that the government should review the salary structure in place of cutting the... looking at the part. And secondly, as far as they did not consider the people, as in workers at the ground level, they are causing more corruption. All they are fighting against corruption will not... I doubt if they will succeed in fighting against corruption because workers at the ground level, as a junior workers, they are...
I don't understand what you're saying. I'm not following you very well, Akpan. There was another angle that the federal government was saying that those who are earning above minimum wage, their salary will be reviewed. We don't know if it's upward or downwards. But they said a committee will be established to determine how to review.
They want to do modulated increase.
Yes, how do you do that? So all that, you see, all in just trying to achieve this 30,000, so it's fair.
Yeah, for everybody.
But is that the way forward? Should in the capitalist society, should it be that fair?
No. What I believe strongly is that the way we have to go about it, you have to look at the primary responsibility of the government.
Right.
The welfare, you cannot sacrifice the welfare of the people. Mm-hmm. Why are you in government in the first place, if not for the interest of the people?
Right.
And if we are agreed on that, the very next thing is for all of us to be prepared to make some sacrifice one way or the other. You know, like we don't want this VAT thing to turn into a Greek gift. That at the end of the day, you begin to look at it, you know, what are they giving us? Because inflation is there.
Yeah.
Because of the nature of our society, no sooner, you know, than this thing is given and they start implementing it, than the, you know, the yam seller, the, you know, the petty traders will like the prices of their goods.
Right.
So at the end of the day, if we leave it at that, we're going to be in trouble because it means that you have given them something with the right hand and you have taken it back with the left. And that's not the intention of the government. Right. Although, if you now ask the question as to whether this is the appropriate time to do it, there can never be an appropriate time.
The vice president says there are actually 19 million Nigerians that pay tax now. They used to be 14 million in 2017, but as of today, we have 19 million.
So it has, something million.
So it's a progress. We're improving. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to say that when a government decides to introduce a policy that's not favorable, like in France, we heard about the yellow vest protests against their fuel tax.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, normally Nigerians, we sit and we talk. Is there anything we can do?
Protest.
Really, apart from, is there anything we can do to say, this is what we want? This is, especially for me, I would like to see the overbloated salary for, you know, the top people looked into. So what can I do as an individual Nigerian watching TV now to ensure that the tax, the VAT may not be increased and that those salaries are cut down?
Carry placard.
All we can do, you know, we do know that government has a responsibility to all of us. And I did say that whoever goes into government must have actually done his own work to know that I'm going into politics is not an ego trip. It's supposed to be service. If we agree that it is service, at the end of it all, then we have to be prepared to do the needful.
Exactly. Let's take a few tweets.
Yes. Andrew here says, let us remove two slices from our legislature. Remove the Senate and then make elected local government chairman to become state house assembly members. The money saved should be used to pay minimum wages. Nobody will answer him. Nobody will agree to this.
We have to round up now. So finally, is there anything else you'd like to tell us concerning this issue?
Because I know
this issue of VAT, because people are really scared.
scared
when you see somebody like Ashwaju saying, don't increase VAT, it means that they are having meetings somewhere where they are planning to increase VAT.
Yes. So, we are scared.
I mean, people are really scared of this imminent increase.
For example, you talked about trust.
Right.
The don't people trust. Are disillusioned.
Yes.
For whatever reason.
We're not seeing anything.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So, and where
they say they will not pay subsidy, they pay subsidy.
They breed mistrust.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But when you look at a state like Lagos, for example, as a model, before Ashwaju Tinubu came to Lagos, was not as.
We have to run off. Unfortunately, I can't let you in the name, but thank you for sharing your views with us. We appreciate
you
being on the show.
Thank
That's all
so
we
much.
Can take on the show. Have a fabulous day. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye bye.
Thank you so much.